morning, everyone. I'm Mary Beth Morris. I'm the immigration advisor here at the university. And today we'll be talking about applying for your F1 visa or your J1 for anyone who's coming as an exchange scholar. And we'll talk a little bit about the process, what it means to apply for a non-immigrant visa, how to go about it, what you need to do, and pretty much just to help you expect to, and best prepare for the experience. Okay, so we'll go ahead and start an overview of the process, and then we'll go through each of these areas very specifically. So if you come up with questions, I have Olivia here with me today. She'll be helping to monitor the chat, and we would ask you to go ahead and just jot your questions into the chat. And at the end, we'll take a chance to kind of go through those. I think a lot of you will have the same questions, so hopefully we're able to answer them all. So to give you an overview of the process, the beginning step would be to receive your admission to Duquesne University. I think at this point, most of you have already done that. Congratulations. And that's the first step. You basically need to be a qualified applicant, and if you've been accepted, then you are. So you're going to receive your admission. We'll go through paying the different fees. This one, you know, says pay the CVIS fee. We'll talk about what that is. What is CVIS? We'll talk about how you fill out your visa application, what that means, where it is. There's also a visa application processing fee. We'll go through that. That'll all take you to the point where you'll actually schedule an interview at a U.S. consulate or embassy in your home country. We'll talk about the documents you'll need to gather, and then basically what to do when you interview and how to prepare best to actually get that visa. So the process, and you can kind of see this here. To receive admission to the university, you've been accepted, you're gonna get some sort of a welcome packet. This used to be sent in the mail. It's very rarely done that way now. It's mostly via email because of the pandemic. And this is an example of an I-20 document. So once you've shown that you're academically qualified to be admitted to Duquesne, then we go through the process of collecting documents from you that show that you're able to afford to pay the cost. So the tuition, the fees for room, board, books, international health insurance, and things like that. So you've probably gone through, maybe even finished that process with me, and we've been able to move you to the next step of issuing you a document for immigration. Now, technically, you're all considered non-immigrants because your plan is not to stay in the U.S., but rather to return to your home country. And that's a very important point that I want to make. That will be something that the U.S. embassy or consulate officials will really look closely to, is your ties to your home country and what that means for you to return to your home country after your educational experience here. So you'll see on this copy of an I-20, the different numbers circled. The very top one is a CVIS number. Each of you would be issued an individual number. CVIS is the Student Exchange Visitor Information System. So that's what the letters stand for. And it basically is an online database that I use with the US government, State Department, to help manage your applications to come to the US to apply for a visa. And then specifically, we issue documents like this I-20 that will show you're applying for an F1 student visa, where you're coming. So you'll see our school code and our school name there. That's that second circle down on the page. And this is an example. This is not a Duquesne I-20. And then you'll see the last circle shows the program start date and end date. It'll list your educational level, the normal length of the program, your major, if English is required. And then down below that, you'll see the estimated costs and then your provisions for how you're going to pay for that funding. So these are all the types of information we've already gathered from you and been able to issue, allowed us to issue the I-20, or for anyone coming on a J-1 visa and as an exchange scholar, that's a different form, that's a DS-2019. So we'll kind of take a look at these and talk a little bit about what each one means. So once you've been issued your immigration document, so you've submitted your financial documents, your proof of financial support, you know, something from the sponsor indicating if you have a sponsor or your parents that'll be paying for you, or if it's your own funds, you know, bank statements of your own. You're going to get the I-20 or the DS-2019. And so now your next step is to actually pay that I-901 fee. And we've got the website listed here. It's a one-time fee, and it's basically collected through the U.S. government as part of the upkeep to the database. So everyone who is coming in on one of these immigrant visas, F-1 or J-1, will pay this fee. It's one time. For an F visa holder, it would be $350. And if you're coming in on a J-1, it would be $220. Those fees are subject to change. That's the current costs right now. I'm not aware of any proposed increase. So hopefully these will hold out for the remainder of this calendar year. So the website listed here, very easy to navigate. You'll click on the green button where it says pay the I-901 fee. And then you'll just follow the instructions to enter the information they're asking. Basically, it's the CVIS number, your name, information that connects that to your record. And then once that fee's been paid, you'll be able to move on to the next step, which we'll talk about here, to actually apply for the visa interview. So when you complete your payments, you're going to also go to the visa application form online. It's called the form DS-160, and you'll complete that information. It's very important that you're always paying attention to the exact spellings in all your documents. If at any point when we issue your I-20 or your DS-2019, you see an error, please let me know right away so that we can update that and make the correction. We always want everything to agree exactly. So your name as it appears on your passport, on your non-immigrant paperwork, DS-2019 or I-20, and certainly things like your acceptance letter, bank statements as well. So pay close attention. That actually will be an important part of the process, that there's no confusion or ambiguity between all of these documents belonging to you. So you're always going to enter the information when you fill this out online, exactly as it appears on your documents. Now there's also a fee for the visa processing. The instructions and the cost will vary depending on what country you're applying. So there's no direct answer as to what that would cost. We've got the website here for usembassy.gov where you can look that up. You'll also be reaching out to schedule your interview. So you'll find out a little bit more as you go through the process with your local embassy or consulate. Once you've paid your CVIS fee, once you've paid your DS-201 or applied for your DS-160 and paid your visa fee, then you're now able to schedule your interview. Any U.S. embassy or consulate can help you. However, during COVID, we're finding you really need to remain in your home country. Unless you reside elsewhere, they're not really considering what they call third country applications. So unless you don't have an open embassy or consulate in your home country, you will need to use the one in your country. And if you don't have one, then there'll be recommendations for bordering countries that you are permitted to use. The wait times do vary. And unfortunately, we have no control over this. It changes sometimes daily or weekly, especially now during COVID. We're finding one day an embassy might reopen to schedule appointments, the next day they may close again. It's been very frustrating for all of us. So do be patient, be persistent, you know, keep signing in, keep logging in, keep checking. Your chance will come. We're hopeful to say that just even this week, we've seen students who have gotten visa appointments and been issued visas. So we do see progress, and that's very good news. So check there with your local embassy or consulate. Find out what the wait times are. There are some provisions for students who are starting as new students, and we're happy to assist you in any way we can. There are what they call national interest exemptions, NIE, for certain countries, certain visa categories like students or exchange visitors that allow you to get some priority. You know, they recognize a lot of you have been waiting for a while. We've had some students unable to get a visa or even get a visa appointment for over 9 months. And that's all because of the COVID worldwide lockdown. So things are starting to open up. As I said, we're very hopeful to see more good news come about. So as you schedule your interview, this is a list of your documents that you'll need to have ready. And we'll talk a little bit more about some of the details of these documents. But essentially, if you're applying for the F1 visa, it would be your I-20 form. If it's for the J-1 visa, it's your DS-2019, both of which would be issued by me. And right now, we're issuing these electronically, which is great because we're permitted to do so, and it's immediate. So as soon as I've issued your document and I can email it to you, you can print it out. It's in your hands. However, we are finding that some embassies and consulates are requesting original documents. So keep that in mind. Once we've issued your document and emailed it to you, we will include instructions on how you can request that original paper document to be shipped to you. There's a link, you'll sign in, you'll create and enter your own address so we know it's right. You'll also pay for it, but you can choose the sort of delivery method you want, the company, if there's one that's best for your city and your country, et cetera. But when you do get your documents electronically, you should print them out. And if you receive them in the mail, either way, you will always need to sign your signature at the bottom of page one. And that verifies that, you know, now this is in your hands, my signature's on it and your signature's on it. So that's the most important form. And we have it listed here at the top. The second one, of course, is your passport. If you haven't already done so, check the expiration date. Typically, visas are not likely to be issued if your passport's getting close to expiring. So check that date. If you've got at least a year left, I'd say you're safe. You're often able to renew your passport here in the US by using your own home country's embassy or consulates here in the US. But do make sure you've checked that date before you even begin the application process for your visa. You'll need usually one, sometimes two passport style photos. So the typical passport headshot, kind of what you're looking at for me right now. And so you can get those ready. The CVIS I-901 receipt, that was the website we showed you a little bit ago, where you would click the green button to pay. You'll get a receipt, very, very important. You want that receipt and you'll need to have that with you for your visa appointment. You'll also be able to print a confirmation page when you've completed the online DS-160 form. So again, print everything, save screenshots if you need to. You'll always need to have these records for you later on. And then when you make the visa payment, again, online, you'll do this at the point of making your visa appointment. You'll also want to print out proof of that payment and likewise have that with you for your visa interview. In terms of the financial documents, these are the same documents that you submitted to us when you applied for your I-20 or your DS-2019. It's very important that they agree with the same and be the same documents you gave to us, as they'll show the exact same amounts that we were able to verify for your own sponsorship. So, you know, on your hands, you can have original bank statements and the scholarship admissions letter we've given to you, those can be printed out. So try to have as many originals as you can. Often the scholarship for you to attend Duquesne is listed in your acceptance letter. So typically that's the same letter. Other things too that show that you were academically admissible to Duquesne. So things like your test scores, your transcripts. We'll talk a little bit more about some details on those. And then most importantly, and again, we'll elaborate on this, is any documents that you have showing your ties to your home country. Again, coming as a student or an exchange visitor is a non-immigrant visa designation, and therefore you're not intending to stay here. And they just want to see that you've got your ties to your home country, you plan to return there. And that's a really key part of this experience. So attending the visa interview. So the consular officer will do an interview. As you can see in that bottom photo, It's actually not a sit-down interview. It is face-to-face. It's typically between glass with the microphone, as you can see. It will be fast. It will probably be only 2 to 5 minutes, probably nowhere near the full 5 minutes from what I'm hearing. They've taken a look at your documents. They'll have questions for you, which we'll talk about what to expect in terms of how to answer them. It will likely be conducted in English. I think for most of you, you've got excellent proficiency, but again, this is a little nerve-wracking. So if it's not your first language, I can understand if you're a little nervous, but they typically will do it in English. Again, we're going to talk about the questions they'll ask, so you'll be able to kind of know your answers in advance. They're going to ask you questions about all these documents that we've told you to bring, and kind of bigger picture questions about your experience coming to the U.S., your expectations and whatnot. So we'll go through those in a moment. And as they ask questions, you'll likely be able to just pull up your documents and to be able to answer them, show your documents as part of your answer. So the types of interview questions, and this could be all of these, it could be a few of these, but these are the most common ones we're hearing from our students. So what are your study plans? Why did you choose your major and that sort of thing? What made you choose Duquesne University? What is your academic capability? If you're starting off maybe in an undergraduate program, but you hope to continue on to a master's or a PhD, being able to kind of talk to that effect, your long-term goals, your financial status. So they're going to look at your financial documents. They're going to look at your ability to pay for your education and your cost of living here. Things about your post-graduation plans. So as I said, if you continue with further studies, that's your intention to know that and to be able to speak very confidently about that. Otherwise, maybe you have job plans. You want to enter the job market or get some experience before you go into grad school. So if you haven't thought about those things, those are very important topics. And I think if you can even sit with someone and discuss it, you'll find it easier to come up with how you would answer those questions. They're going to ask you about your family and your background. Have others in your family studied abroad? Have they studied in the U.S.? What makes you pick the U.S. and that sort of thing? And just any other general questions that might relate to this. So, these are really important topics. I think the more you can think about them in advance, the more prepared you'll be when the questions are asked. So questions about your study plans. As I said, what is your major? Why did you pick it? How long is the degree program? If it's an undergraduate degree, you're starting off as a first year student, it will likely take 4 years. Some of our programs might take 5 or 6, but in the end you end up with also a master's or a doctorate as part of that program. So really know how that program works here at Duquesne. What do you already know about your field of study? What kind of helped you to choose it? Is it something you've had some experience in already? Is it someone in your family perhaps already is in that career? Or it's a tradition, that it's being kind of handed down from family and you're the next one to take part in it. So, just kind of be able to answer some of those questions. And then of course, how will the study program relate to your past work or studies? So especially if you're coming in as a graduate student and you're able to see the bigger picture of what you want to do. You've had a couple years of experience in the field. Now you need the higher degree to continue to be promoted or to approach it from a new direction. So really, having some answers to these are going to help you immensely because you're going to be much more comfortable about it. And it's going to seem really to be kind of a second nature. So this one, I actually spelled out how Duquesne sounds. What made you choose Duquesne University? And I wrote it this way, even though it looks silly, because it is a very hard to pronounce name. A lot of people have no idea. It's actually a French word. And Duquesne is how it's pronounced. So I think being able to feel comfortable about how to pronounce the name is a good first step. Overall questions in terms of how you chose Duquesne. Did you apply to other universities? How many accepted you? How many admitted you as a student? How many rejected you? And these should be honest answers. If this is, Duquesne is your first choice, your only choice, be forthright about that. But I think they want to kind of look at the picture as to how you ended up choosing Duquesne. Do you happen to know any of the professors here? It's probably unlikely that you do, but maybe you do. And that gives you a bit of a connection. And another good, good question is to be able to know what city we are located in and in what state. I think it's just one of those things, you know, that you have a sense of where you're going. So of course we're located in Pittsburgh and the state is Pennsylvania. So pull up a map if you need to. We're all on the website. You can find out where we are exactly. But we're in a great location. We're close to the East Coast. We're about 5 hours drive from Washington, DC, a little longer than from New York City. So we're really within good driving distance of a lot of key US cities. So in terms of your academic capability, we're talking about test scores. So what are those test scores? Things like the GRE or the GMAT, those are both used for graduate schools. The TOEFL or the IELTS, if your you know, proficiency in English is something of issue. And if you're coming in to study English as a second or a foreign language, it's okay if your scores are low, if you've even taken the tests, because we know you'll enter and be placed appropriately in the English language courses. Since you're going to have transcripts with you of your previous experiences, make sure you are well aware of what they say. What was your previous GPA in high school or previous university level work? You know, have those transcripts handy to be able to show your success there. What do you know about U.S. schools in general? How will you manage the cultural and educational differences in the U.S.? That's a big question and a difficult one to answer. But I think if you know to expect things will be different, that there'll be adjustments on your part, but certainly know that here in our office at the Center for Global Engagement, we are here to support you in all ways that we can. So that's a big part of us welcoming an international population. We know there will be cultural and educational differences, and our office is here to help, as are many offices across campus. So they're very eager to welcome you and to assist you as you might need. So having your diplomas with you, your transcripts, they might want to know how good is your English, how long have you spoken English, you know, kind of have those answers and kind of be ready to answer that. So we'll pull up the I-20 here again, just to give you an idea of the finances. This is a big part, I'd say one of the more important parts when it comes to you proving your ability to finance your education. A big part of this experience for the visa interview is that they want to know that you can afford to come here. It's not cheap to come to the United States. You've got your flights, your cost of living, and then on top of that, of course, the cost of your education. So I think they want to make sure visa applicants fully understand how the expenses work. So questions about, you know, that red circled area here on the screen. Who is your sponsor? Are you paying for it yourself? Is it your parents? If it's a sponsor, is it a family member? What's their connection to you? Maybe what's their education and occupation? You know, is this, are they eager to support you in maybe their field of work and hope to hire you when you graduate? Those things are great topics to kind of be prepared for. One specific question here is in terms of what is their monthly or annual income? And I'm going to mention this here, and then it's listed down below again. I think a very, very important part is to look at understanding the exchange rate between your home currency and the US dollar. They're very all over the place. They could be very close. They could be very far apart. But ultimately, it could make the cost of US education even more expensive if there's a great disparity between the exchange rates. So definitely pay attention to that. Be able to explain that you know what the exchange rate is, you know what that cost would be in US dollars, but also in your local currency, just to give a sense of understanding. When you do an I-20 or your DS-2019, we're only looking for you to prove that you can cover the costs for 1 year, your first year of your education. But there's more than 1 year to your education. So they may ask you, how do you plan to fund the entire cost. So be prepared with that. Likewise, you know, the scholarships that you have, family support, bank, money that you put in the bank, sponsors, But it's not just 1 year, even though that's all you have to prove for the I-20, but they will ask you a little bit about the full experience, you know, the whole length of your program. And then near the bottom, you know, they're going to ask about your bank statements. They may also ask about tax returns. So depending on how your country, you know, does taxes, whether it's income taxes like we do here in the U.S., just kind of be prepared for that, I think, to be able to say, oh, yes, this is what we pay. And, you know, this is what we expect to pay in taxes, but to also have a sense of, you know, we certainly still have the funds to finance an education in the U.S. A big part of the interview questions could run along the lines of your graduation plans. After graduating, what do you plan to do? Do you have a job in mind, a career? Do you actually have a job offer? You know, is that in your home country? Is that with a family business? The third question down that I have bolded, do you plan on returning back to your home country? The question is very important. It's almost a trick question, because ultimately the answer is yes, you do plan on returning back, because remember, this is a non-immigrant visa category. So the answer is yes, you do plan on returning back. You know, you may have a job offer there, you may not. Things could change. That's probably the best way to look at it. Maybe ultimately you won't return back, but at this point, applying for a non-immigrant visa, it's very important that you indicate, yes, you do plan to return back to your home country. And the last question here is, how will you use the skills and knowledge that you gain in your degree program? Again, you know, specifically going into a career, going on to graduate school, and that sort of thing. So really have it all thought out. There'll probably be questions about your family, especially let's say if your family is helping to finance your education. They may ask what your parents do. They may ask their income, of course, if they're your sponsors. They want to see if they really do have the financial resources to maintain paying for your entire education, not just the first year. They may ask where your parents live, how many siblings you have, family. And a very big question we often hear is the question of, do you have any relatives in the U.S.? That's also kind of a trick question, because if you do have relatives, they may want to make sure that you don't have intentions to immigrate and to join them. Remember, you're coming as a non-immigrant. But of course, you always want to answer the questions honestly. So if you do have relatives in the U.S., be honest. Maybe you have a cousin who's also a student. Maybe you have a relative who had been a student and was able to get a green card. So answer the questions forthrightly and honestly. But that is an important part when they look at your ties to your home country, or whether you seem to have ties in the U.S. So some general questions to keep in mind. They may want to ask you, what made you pick the U.S.? Why not another country such as the UK or Australia, if you wanted two English-speaking countries? Why not stay in your home country and study there? Maybe this is a field of study that you know an education here in the U.S. Would really put you, you know, far advanced of a degree from your home country. So something like that's a great answer. If you happen to be currently working and leaving a current job, they will likely want to know why. What's important enough that you would stop working to get a degree in another country? This next question is bolded as well on purpose. Do you plan to work in the U.S.? That's also almost a trick question, because on a student visa or an exchange visitor visa, your main reason to be here is a student. Any work that you might be approved to do will be very limited and will be secondary to your education. So the answer of do you plan to work in the U.S. is no, because you plan to be a student. So just kind of keep that in mind. There might be work that in your field that you could be approved to do that's educational and adds to your curriculum, but that's all secondary. You're mainly here to be a student. They may ask you, what will you do if your visa is denied? do you have backup plans? If your visa is denied, usually you can wait a period of time and reapply. So that's probably your answer. Wait and try again. They may ask if you've been to the U.S. before. There's no right or wrong answer, so answer honestly. That may have been what led you to choose coming to the U.S. or specifically to Duquesne. Maybe you've been here before. And then a question of will you return to your home country during vacation periods? Again, honest answer. If you do travel home, that usually is going to incur more costs for those flights. You are entitled to stay during vacations here in the U.S. Between sessions, maybe a month over the Christmas holiday, and again, several months between May and August in our summertime. So you are able to stay, and if costs prohibit you from returning home, that's perfectly fine. We love to have students here over the breaks, and they're quite welcome. So if your visa is approved, we put a little screenshot here of what a typical visa would look like. It's a sticker in your passport. It's the whole size of one whole page, and it's permanently placed inside your passport once it's issued. You'll see some of the things that are circled on the top right. It says visa type or class. This one was issued for an F1 student status. Just below that, you'll see the expiration date. This one happens to show an expiration date of the 8th of July of 2014. And then just further to the left, you'll see under the word entries, the letter M. And that stands for multiple entries, so that you can come and go freely and use this visa up until its expiration date. One thing I will mention, it's not as important now, but something you can start thinking about is this visa is not able to be renewed once you're in the US. However, because it is what allows you to get into the US, if it expires and you have a valid I-20 or your valid DS-2019, it's okay. Those documents, those non-immigrant documents, are what keep you in a valid status as a student or an exchange visitor. But I get a lot of questions over the years, how do I renew my student visa or my J visa from within the US? And the answer is you cannot. That is something you always have to do from your home country. But always stay in touch with me and with our office in terms of being aware of expiration dates as things get close. You know, if we need to extend your program, if you're not gonna graduate on time, you know, always just kind of keep those things in mind. But since we're looking at this visa page, I'll kind of make mention of the visa as well. So as you get your visa, you know, continue to plan for your pre-departure. We'll be doing other webinars like this. We're actually beginning to prepare for some online portions of orientation. So we'll have some online sessions coming up later at the end of the summer. Stay in contact with us. You know, let us know you've gotten your visa. Let us know if you've made your plans when you're arriving, so that we can plan for your arrival. When you're issued your I-20 and or DS-219, you can arrive up to 30 days, but no more than 30 days before the program start date. So depending on the date for your documents for the fall, it might be as early as the 24th of July. It might actually be earlier. So look at your specific document to see that date. And if you happen to be attending the session today, but you're coming in January, most of the time, your start date for classes would be around January, or orientation would be January 12th, which means you could arrive as early as December 13th. So just kind of keep that in mind. The 30 days beforehand is a reasonable amount of time, I think, for you to arrive. We don't completely know how things will work with COVID, if there'll be a required quarantine period. So if you're wondering, certainly reach out and ask us if we happen to give you an update. And we'll try to take that all into consideration as we assist you in your arrival. If for some reason your visa was denied, what should you do? Do not panic. Like I said, for the most part, you can always apply again. It might mean that you have to defer beginning your classes. We're happy to help you to do that here at Duquesne. Most often you will find out why you were denied. They typically refer to a code in the federal regulations. And you can look that up and see what it was maybe that you didn't present. I'd say one of the most common things we see is that you didn't sufficiently provide ties to your home country, meaning that they don't feel convinced that you, you know, are really coming as a non-immigrant. So keep that in mind. That is probably the most important thing you'll want to choose to make clear and to speak comfortably about during the interview. Again, you can apply again if you've been denied. So if you know what you were missing, certainly add that documentation to your files of what to bring next time. As I said, emphasizing ties to your home country tends to be one of the most important things in terms of visa issuance. So general tips, if you haven't already, you know, complete these steps as soon as you can. As I said, making your appointments, you know, find out if you need the original paper documents so that we can get those shipped off to you via post. Go through and practice your interview in English. As I said, I think it's important that you have a sense of being comfortable speaking about these topics, being able to answer these questions, kind of rehearse it with someone. Really one of the best ways to feel ready. And then be able to explain the purpose of your F1 or your J1 visa and how your plans fit into that visa type. Some of you might be coming as exchange students from partner universities worldwide. You're coming as a very temporary person, sometimes one semester, sometimes two. But as an exchange visitor, you're ultimately returning home to get your degree from your home institution. So that's, you know, being able to understand that would be different than, let's say, an F1 student who's coming to get their degree here. So, you know, really kind of know your category. It might sound mundane, but wear proper clothing. You want to be respectful. So to be able to arrive, you know, properly dressed, I think, you know, being able to come across as certainly honest and confident. You know, you want to be polite, but brief. Again, your time in this interview is quite limited. So the more you can rehearse and feel prepared for it, I think the better you'll ultimately do. As I said, be familiar with your documents. You know what you have, be able to put your hands on it quickly, know what's what. Remember ultimately what the consular official is looking for. You know, your intention is to be a student for a short term or an exchange visitor for a short term and to return home. So just keep that in mind with all of your documents and as you, you know, kind of prepare your answers. And again, I'm going to restate this as one of the most important things. Emphasize that you have no plans to immigrate to the U.S., but that you do have strong ties to your home country. So, of course, that might mean family. We see students who leave a spouse and maybe, young children at home because they know this is a short-term purpose. They're going to return home. Obviously, their family's there waiting for them. If you have property, if you own property, if you have investments, if you have career prospects or a job offer, all of those things are going to tie back, tie you back to your home country and help to really, I think, solidify your plans to return home. Questions we're seeing a lot now with COVID. My country, it might be on lockdown, including your banks. How do you get financial documents? Right now, we're happy to accept electronic documents to whatever extent your bank can provide them or if you have online access. Keep in mind, you probably are going to want the most official documents you can get your hands on for the visa interview. However, for us, we recognize that your ability to get these things might be quite limited. And you're sending them to us electronically anyway, so we don't need to see have originals in hand, but the embassy or consulate probably will. What if there are no visa appointments in my country? What can I do? Be patient. We know how challenging it is, but we're seeing success as students wait it out. As I said, they're trying to give priority to students with early start dates. So that might mean you have to wait a little longer because there are others ahead of you who maybe you're starting in June or July. So just, be persistent, but be respectful and work out the closest appointment that you can get. What if your deposit deadline is approaching, but you don't have your visa? Can you pay the deposit later? We're happy to help work with you to make exceptions for the deposits, your enrollment deposits here at Duquesne. But I will say, if in order to defer you to a future semester, you will have to pay that deposit for us to bump you forward. So just kind of keep that in mind. If we get to that point, you know, that'll be an important part of the process. What if you can't arrive in time for your fall classes because of visa problems? Well, we know that might be the case, and we are trying to be as flexible as possible. We are expecting to have classes in person in the fall at this point. So we can't guarantee that there would be an option for you to begin classes online. We're not sure that they would be available. But certainly keep in touch with us to keep us apprised of any updates, and we'll be happy to work with you. As I said, we are planning for in-person courses for this fall. Duquesne will return fully in person for the fall. We have been hybrid this past year, and we're finding that, you know, it's our plans to return to in-person. So as I said, it might not be possible to take classes online, which might mean you'll need to defer to January if you can't make it here for fall. In terms of us offering any online courses, it's unlikely, but it would only happen if there's another major lockdown in the US. So at this point, we think that's not likely to happen, but as always, it could be a possibility. We will always be monitoring our local and US requirements. Certainly check your email for any updates from us, and kind of keep in touch with your own country and their recommendations for travel. So what do you need to do? Submitting your documents for processing for the fall semester right now. If you're coming for January, just be patient. We're not quite ready to start doing those documents yet. You can apply for your visa as soon as possible. So according to what the consulate will allow you to do, check your mail regularly, your email for any updates about our plans, and certainly continue to keep us updated when you've scheduled your visa interview, when you're approved for your visa, and when you will arrive to campus. We are also trying to find out for sure in terms of requirements regarding COVID, whether you will need to have the COVID vaccine before beginning classes. We've been offering the vaccine on campus, so if you're unable to get it at home, we'll be in touch as to how you could get it here on campus or here in the US, and that sort of thing. So, you know, just keep abreast of your emails, reach out with specific questions if you have them. And if necessary with all of this, if we have to, we will be happy to help you defer your admission. If you're buying flights, try to purchase flights that will allow you to make changes. And as always, you know, continue to safeguard your health and to be safe in all you're doing. There's links here. I know this it's not helpful looking at it right now, but we'll be sending this presentation along to you with specific visa tips for certain locations. Just note that these were made pre-pandemic, so things could have changed. But again, these were insights provided to us, you know, over the past few years. And any questions, I'm always here to help. There's several of us on staff that you've probably been interacting with, whether it's Megan Evangelist, Aaron Morelli, myself, Michael Burke, our director, but we're here to help. You know, we're working through the summer to help prepare for you and to prepare for orientation. So we're very excited to welcome you and hopefully see you here in person in just a couple months. So I'm going to jump over to Olivia and see if we have any questions specifically that I haven't addressed that we can help answer for all of you.
Okay, thanks, Mary Beth. One question we have is, what are your plans after you complete your PhD? I think maybe they're asking for tips for the visa interview.
Yeah, that's a great question. Considering a PhD would be basically a terminal degree, you know, it's unlikely you would have any further studies after that. The questions often kind of go around two areas. You know, do you plan on teaching? A lot of people that get a PhD would like to teach. So maybe you plan to teach and return home. Or some people, both and or, would work in research. Again, depending on the field. So if those are specific questions that you might feel you could be asked, think about your goals for attaining the PhD, and ultimately one or both of those are typically the answers that we see.
And we have a lot of students asking about this recording. So we will be sending it out later today. If you joined late, look forward to receiving it in your email later today. Here's another question. Is there any OPT after a PhD program?
Yes, so this person knows what they're talking about. So OPT stands for Optional Practical Training. And that is available to students after completing a bachelor's, again after a master's, and then again after a PhD. So basically at each level of studies of those three levels. And it's permission for students who are on an F1 visa to remain in the US for 1 year after graduation to look for employment in their field of study. So yes, it would be available to someone on the PhD level. It would be available once at each of those levels. So if you've gotten a degree, more than one master's degree, for example, you can only do it one time at the master's level, but it's a great experience. We talk about it at length once students are here, and to how that can kind of enhance and add to your academic experience.
I have another question. A student says, my financial support documents are from a U.S. bank because my sister is helping pay for my tuition and fees. Can this affect the decision of my visa?
I don't think it's something to worry about affecting it negatively. We actually see a good handful of students have sponsors in the U.S. And so I get these bank statements from a U.S. bank in U.S. dollars. And I've seen those students get their visas and be able to come. And again, you'd have a family tie in the US, but it doesn't have to be a negative one in terms of interfering with getting the visa.
Anyone have any other questions? Feel free to type them out in the chat. Okay. Here's another one. What is the last date to defer to summer 2022 because my country is still in lockdown?
We are happy to wait as long as we possibly need to, possibly can, to defer a student. So let's say, you were trying to come for this fall and you couldn't make it up until the first week of classes. If you're not here, we'll probably be reaching out to you to say, oh, we see you didn't make it, or we know you've had trouble. And then being able to push back, whether it be to the future spring or future summer or even a whole future year later. So we're not too strict with deadlines. But again, in order to defer, you'd have to have made your enrollment deposit. So just work with us and we'll be happy to help.
Okay, and what is the last day for international students to arrive for fall 2021?
That's an excellent question. We typically know, especially because classes will be in person, that the latest you would want to arrive is within the first week of the beginning of classes. Classes start on Monday, August 23rd. And so I would say the latest you would want to arrive would be within 7 days of that. And that's for a couple of reasons. Mostly classes are online. We know that it's not good to miss the beginning of a semester or to miss too many classes. And we find that if you do just kind of start off, behind and try to catch up, it's very, very challenging and very difficult. And it's often reflected in the grades. So for your success, we would say within that first week of classes would be about the latest. So that's a very good question.
Okay, are there any other questions? Okay. Oh, there's another one.
One more.
What happens if the first available visa interview date is later than my start date for classes.
We see that. We're seeing that a lot now because of COVID. Some students are reaching out to say, I'm trying to come for August. I can't get a visa appointment until November. I would say at this point, we don't need to defer you yet. I would say make the appointment if you can for the soonest date, but continue to check back with the consulate or embassy. They do sometimes have cancellations, and closer and sooner appointments would open up. Again, I'd say be persistent and be patient, but at this time it's not surprising. We're seeing that in quite a few locations across the globe. Okay, I think that's it. I think that was our last question. So we'll be, as Olivia mentioned, we've recorded this. We'll be sending it out to all of you who are registered. We'll also have the PowerPoint, so you'll have some of the links and things that you can follow up on. But we're very glad you joined us, and we're even more excited to hopefully welcome you here in the next couple of months to campus. So thanks. Be persistent. You know, we know you can get that visa interview and keep us apprised of your successes. So we'll be in touch. Have a great day. Bye-bye.